Hey guys, this is Austin, and this is the cheapest gaming PC we've ever built, at just under $300. Let's put this thing together and see how it actually performs. And huge shout out to LastPass for sponsoring this video. If you guys have watched the channel for a while, you know that I've been using LastPass for years, since way before they ever actually sponsored a video. Now LastPass really is the single spot that you can keep all of your passwords not only safe, but also secure, so you just don't have to worry about them anymore. With LastPass, you never need to write down, remember, or reset another password. They're all kept safe and secure on the LastPass Vault, and the best part is that it will generate a unique and secure password for every single site you visit, which is especially helpful if you're one of those people who uses the same password for every single site you use. John.
What?
LastPass will autofill your passwords across your computer as well as your phone, where it works not only on websites, but also inside of apps. On top of that, LastPass has some great two-factor authentication options, including support for the YubiKey, which is what I use on my personal account. If you're not already using LastPass to keep your passwords and logins safe and secure, definitely be sure to go check it out at the link in the description. And of course, huge shout out to LastPass for sponsoring this video. Now let's go and build a PC. If you remember the very first $300 Boson we did, it was taking advantage of an AMD Athlon processor, so it's only fitting that this newer version has a much, much newer version, the Athlon 200GE. Unlike older Athlons, this is taking advantage of the newer Ryzen architecture. So inside we have two Zen cores which are clocked at 3.2 gigahertz. They do support hyperthreading, as well as importantly we also have AMD Vega graphics built in. Mind you, it's Vega 3, so it's about the smallest version of Vega you can get, but this is a big step up over those earlier Athlons and actually should give us enough performance for gaming. I hope so. It's a $55 processor, so. Backing it up, we have 8 gigabytes of Corsair Vengeance LPX RAM. Now what's important about this is that anytime you're using something with integrated graphics such as the Athlon 200GE, you want to give it as much memory bandwidth as possible, which is why we're going with dual channel memory. And while 8 gigs isn't a ton, especially for such a cheap system that's less than $300, it should be just fine. Everything is going inside the Gigabyte A320M S2H. Now this is a very cheap motherboard, but importantly because we are based on the newer Ryzen chipset, we actually have a lot of the higher end features. So not only will it support our Athlon processor, but you could go all the way up to something like a Ryzen 7 2700X if you ever want to upgrade, although that might be a slightly ambitious upgrade, but we do have support for DDR4 and importantly an M.2 SSD. That's important because we're using a 128GB 8-data M.2 SSD. Now first of all, an SSD is always faster than a standard mechanical hard drive, but one of the nice things about budget builds is that this is actually cheaper than a full hard drive. Now with only 128GB of capacity, it's not going to be great, but it definitely should be enough to install a few games and get us up and running. Again, this computer is all about getting us ready to go right now with plenty of upgrade potential later. Like buying a hard drive, or more memory, or a graphics card, or a better processor. All these things are possible at some point, but not today. When you build a budget computer, there are a lot of ways that you can cut corners and save a little bit of money. One area you shouldn't cut corners on is with the power supply. So this is a 450 watt EVGA 80 plus bronze unit. Now the 80 plus is important. Yes, you could save probably like 15, 20 bucks by getting a cheap Diablo Tech power supply, and it would work for like 15 minutes if you're building a backpack PC, but for something that's actually going to last you a few years and importantly give you a little bit of upgrade capacity in the future, going with something that's a little bit high quality is definitely worth the few extra dollars that it costs. So what I like about this case is, like I was saying, it actually has some features, which is not always a given when you spend a very, very small amount of money on a case. So with this guy, we do get an 80 millimeter exhaust fan, and it also has a full USB 3.0 port, like a single one, but you know, USB 3 is nice on a very, very cheap case. Look at this. We even have a little dust filter on the bottom, which is actually not super important because the power supply is on the top, but okay, I'll take that. I like how just ridiculously lightweight this case is. So we do have our USB 3.0 port on the side. You also do have a pair of USB 2s on the front, and once we get the motherboard in, we'll have a few more around the back. I'm guessing that would open up our optical drive if we had one, but in true cheap PC building fashion, instead of an optical drive, that's where we're gonna stuff all of our extra cables that we don't need. So I've actually built a system in this case before, and it is a little bit tight, but it's not too bad. And one of the nice things is it is a full micro ATX case, which means you're gonna save a little bit of room on your desk or underneath your desk or wherever you wanna put it. The main issue here is that there's basically no room around back for cable management, but For a system like this, especially considering how basic it is, I think we'll be just fine. Now, I'm not doing a full PC build tutorial in this video. If you guys want to check that out, we do one every year, and I'll link it in the description as well as on a card. But the system itself actually should be pretty easy to put together. One of the nice things about this is because it is so cheap, there are very few components, and it's not really that difficult to work inside the case. Basically, what I'm saying is that if this is the very first time you've ever built a computer, it is hard to go wrong with something like this. It is about as simple as it gets. I'm actually kind of excited to see just how well this performs. So I did take a look at the Ryzen 3 and the Ryzen 5 chips with integrated graphics a little bit earlier this year, and they were impressive, but they're also like double the price of this. Mind you, this is like half the CPU cores and less than half the GPU, but considering that we can build this entire system for less than $300, I really just want to see how good is it really. Also, wow, that is some incredibly well applied thermal paste. Do you see that? Like, look how perfect it is. I feel bad about ruining it. Squash. Because RAM is so expensive these days, the 8 gigs of RAM is actually the most expensive part of this build. Now, you could get away with 4, especially if you're not really trying to do all that much gaming, you'd be just fine. But considering that I actually want to have enough RAM to, you know, open up a couple tabs in Chrome and also play a game of Fortnite, I feel like 8 gigs is a worthy investment. And the nice thing about this board is that even though it's not really super simple to upgrade since you only have 2 DIMM slots, you could in theory bump this up to 16 gigs later once RAM prices eventually, you know, come back down to earth. So if we screw our SSD into place, we're actually almost done. This is a very simple build. All that's left now is to put the motherboard inside the case, get everything wired up, and we can actually see how well our awesome $300 system performs. Or how not awesome it performs. A little bit of cable management, installing Windows, and a couple of software updates later, let's see how the actual system performs. The spiritual successor to the Boson. So to start out with, we have the good old classic, Cinebench. Now this is not an incredibly powerful system with only a dual core Ryzen based CPU as well as those Vega 3 graphics, but well, I have to benchmark things because that's what I do. Not too bad. So we've got 122 on single core and 355 on the multi-core. Now the only issue with these Athlon chips, I mean, I guess there's a couple, is that there's really no overclocking capability unlike the Ryzen chips. But because this is a full desktop processor, we look like we're pretty much running at 3.2 gigahertz across the board. 1322. So definitely not setting the world on fire. But again, this is better than the equivalent Intel integrated graphics. Getting into a real game, we have CSGO. Now on medium settings at 1080p, we've got somewhere between 50 to 60 FPS. If we want to go a little bit higher, we can turn the settings down, but this is pretty playable. Just stay still. Stay still, I got you. Damn, all right. Wow, we all died together. So Fortnite does run. It's at 720p at medium settings, but we do get a pretty respectable 35 frames per second. I would love to show you Overwatch, but for some reason, when I actually try to open the game, even though it's running here, it just turns off the monitor. Like, legitimately, it just turns the whole thing off. Like, I can Alt-Tab back in, and Windows pops right up. Nothing is crashing. Just, the monitor doesn't like Overwatch? Yeah, there we go. Hamster Dude wins again. So Overwatch is actually kind of playable. Now, mind you, we are running it on low settings, and it's at 75% scale at 1080p, which is, I think, roughly 1600 by 900-ish, if my math is right. But yes, it's totally playable. We're getting about 40 frames per second or so. Next up, we have Call of Duty Black Ops 4, a game which should not be able to run on the system, but I'm going to try anyway. Oh, yep. See, yeah, sure, whatever. Yeah, it's fine. Low, off, low, off. Perfect, that sounds exactly like what we need right now. Based on the 12 frame per second loading screen, I don't have high hopes right now. I don't think it's gonna work. The problem with Black Ops is it actually just needs too much RAM. So in addition to having CPU memory, we also have to keep in mind that the graphics is sharing that same 8 gigs of RAM. So when you combine it all together, Black Ops is just not being cooperative. Which I guess is reasonable since it was very specifically told me at the beginning that it was not going to work, but I wanted to try it anyway. That, my friends, is the cheapest gaming PC we've built in a very, very long time. As always, links to check out all of this stuff will be in the description.